Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Greg Walsh. I'm the emergency manager for the city of Salem. I'm going to put this pen down so I stop clicking. Thank you again for joining us for our lunchtime discussions for emergency preparedness. Today, we are talking about emergency shelters during disasters. Let me just make sure that I am sharing my screen. It's kind of important to this. All right, so here we go. You all should hopefully see emergency shelters, shelter discussion up on the slide. So with that being said, there's, Kathy is not with us today. She's, I don't know if she's out or what, but I am hopefully going to be able to enable everybody to continue to see this screen. I have chat open over here. So thank you all for joining us again, as always, for those of you that have joined me a few times. And if not, please share this. We do actually put this live on YouTube. We stream it live on YouTube, and then we'll edit out the front section where I'm kind of futzing around for a few minutes. But this goes into our emergency preparedness playlist that is on the City of Salem's YouTube channel. So today we are talking specifically about emergency shelters and just some of the considerations for that. So got one more person popping into the room. So with emergency shelters, there's a number of considerations, and I'm going to kind of walk through some of the considerations to think about. Talk about things that I have, the way I kind of do things in part of our plan. Again, this goes back to what works for you and what your plan enables you to do in your space. So one of the first things we'll talk about is when would we need to shelter? And this goes back to a number of different reasons why we would consider sheltering. And it also, this, by looking at this, would also determine the type of sheltering that we need. Now, earthquake is kind of that big, obvious one. It's one of those things that if our home is damaged and we experience an earthquake, we may need to shelter either at home or go to a shelter. Sorry. Oh boy. If our home is damaged for some reason, if there's a tree branch that comes down, if there's something else that occurs that damages our home and we need to evacuate our home, if there's a power outage and we are either too cold, it's gone a couple of days, there's other issues that we actually need to evacuate our home. Or form our home more into a warm shelter. Same thing with earthquake and some of these others. It may not be that you have to evacuate your home, but actually just use a portion of your house as a shelter while the rest of your house is either being repaired or managed. If there's flooding and you have to evacuate, home fires and wildfires are two very common causes why people have to consider shelter. And then, as always, I ask people to consider planning for their pets and their families. So one of the first things, the shelter in place first evacuation, right? So in some situations, we may need to evacuate. Hopefully we don't. You know, we all have our homes. There's been plenty of cases where people, don't want to evacuate for some reason or other, whether it's because, hey, it's my home, all my stuff's here, my pets are here, my family won't know where I'm going. And we can alleviate some of those biggest concerns about why we would not evacuate in a hazardous condition by having a good plan for it. And then again, based on the scenario, we can really consider the shelter that we can take with us and based on where we're going. So based on what the situation is, what are our sheltering needs? And then how do we manage that effectively? Again, goes back to planning, goes back to what you can manage, and how that works. Now, if you can't evacuate or don't want to, and it's that shelter in place factor, right? There's a number of reasons why you may shelter in place. Either you can't go anywhere. You know, in some large earthquake scenarios, we talk about the roads will be disrupted. The bridges will be down. There will be no availability to get anywhere outside of the impacted area. So if you have a home that you can be self-sufficient in, it may not be the entire home, but it may be your garage. It may be one or two rooms. And how do we improve that to make sure that we have a good ability to stay sheltered and safe in our home? And it might just be, hey, using one room while we rebuild the rest of our home, which sounds crazy, but that is the case in some situations. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about this home shelter options here. So shelter options for traveling. Now, some of these are the easy, like, okay, thanks, Greg. Like, thanks for giving us the easy answer, but an RV or a camper. If you do have an RV or camper of any sort, you are a lot closer to being 100% prepared for a situation where you need a shelter. If you have an RV, you know, keep a little bit of stock in there. Always. I hit this hour and I just start yawning. I'm sorry. But we hit that point where if you do have an RV or a camper of any sort and you keep supplies in there, it can make a huge difference in your initial sheltering option and your initial just staying okay. And then same thing, kind of that car top tents that have become a lot more popular recently. There's a ton of brands out there for all different types of vehicles. Now, I am a more traditional camper. I have a couple different tents that I've used for hiking and camping and backpacking. And again, that really comes down to what you have or what you identify as your need. I also have a hammock. As in my last the last presentation I gave in my car kits, I talk about the Hennessy hammock. That is actually the image from the first slide of this presentation. I'll just go back to that real quick. But this is the one that has the rain fly and bug net built into it. My thought is if I'm traveling, I'm trying to travel light. If I'm on foot and I am a lot more likely to find two locations that I can, or two things I can tie a hammock to, then I can maybe find space to set up a tent or something like that. Now, there are considerations. If you've never slept in a hammock overnight, it does get cold underneath. So having a good hammock blanket or having a space blanket to put under there can be very, very useful. Then there's the kind of more emergency style or military style, where we have just tarps or canopies that we can set up and use just to keep the rain off you and keep a little bit of warmth in. If that's the course of action that you go with, there's a ton of really amazing tips and tricks as to how to, you know, have that single string line, have it folded over, and then how to make basically a contained space that would actually keep warmth. So what do you put down beneath it, whether it's pine boughs or a lot of leaves that create an insulated layer? How do you fold a tarp underneath? And then how do you actually fold in to make end caps so it keeps that warmth in or creates that in and out and a little bit of privacy with tarps? And then a bivy bag is basically a waterproof sleeping bag that you generally stick your regular sleeping bag into. And it's, you're just sleeping in a big mummy sack is essentially what it looks like. That is part of the military sleep system. So for me, you know, I have a couple of them, the military sleep system, which is a cool weather bag, a cold weather bag, and then a bivy sack. And really, if it's extreme weather, you double up the bags and you slip it all into that waterproof pouch, seal it shut over your face, and that's it. And you kind of just end up with this little breathing space, and you have the hole on the side. So that way rain doesn't get in, but you can still breathe and have fresh air. But that's an option. It's a really lightweight and waterproof option. So it can be really useful for a lot of situations. On one of my previous slides, I discussed that evacuation thought is, if we're going from Salem and we are evacuating on foot for some reason, and we're trying to get to an airport that is still open and functional, you know, we might be walking to Redmond, which if I can remember that slide, and I think I have it open somewhere. You know, the consideration there is a very long walk. Let's see, it is about 132 miles if you walked from downtown Salem to the Redmond airport. Which is 4 to 5 days of 12-hour walking with about 6,000-foot elevation increase. So if you are an avid hiker and that's something that you can do, and a backpacker, like, all for it, go for it. Take your light stuff, but think about what you need. But if you can't, you know, what is the lightest options that you can go with? And sometimes it's a tarp and a sleeping bag or a bivy bag. So that's just one of those considerations if you're traveling, if you are going away from your home. Now, this also consideration here is, where are you going? Are you going to a friend's house? Are you going to a business? Are you going to a mass camp shelter situation? For example, if, you know, we have a massive earthquake or a landslide or something, and homes are just washed away, and we're gathering everybody that that needs help, and we are using, let's say, one of the high school ball fields, and we're setting up a camp. What are you going to want for your own sheltering and your privacy and just containment of your supplies? So that's one of those things that I'll get into here in a few minutes, but how will you keep your supplies contained? And I'll get to that here in a minute. So sheltering at home. So first off, same as traveling. If you're at home and you are, you have an RV and your home is damaged and you're working on repairing your home, hang on your RV. It's going to be a better, more contained option, better heating, better sustainability. It's all around kind of a good option if you have it, but I personally don't have an RV, so that's not an option for me. So I've planned other options, right? So again, it goes back to that same, do you have a tent? Do you have a car top tent? Actually vehicles. So unfortunately, a lot of people live in vehicles, but they are insulated. They can be warm. They can charge devices. They can provide some entertainment for kids if needed. They can just be a contained space for pets and kids and other things you may need to contain in a damaged house.
Excuse me.
So I did not mention just vehicles as its own shelter for traveling, just a regular vehicle. There are plenty of ways of improving a vehicle or having, you know, a tarp. So that way, if all of your stuff is in the back, you drive for a while, you pull over, you cover all your stuff outside or on the roof, you put it on the roof, you cover it, and then you sleep inside. There's definitely some great ways to make that a little bit more comfortable. And again, I'll talk about that, I think, on one of the next slides. But at home, so this is a consideration that if there's an earthquake and your home is partially damaged, your windows are broken, which is going to be a really common thing that we'll see, is a lot of glass broken. Some unreinforced buildings may be damaged. Some older buildings may be damaged as well. But if you have a room that is mostly closed off, for us, we consider our garage, because it's on a concrete slab that is not on the hillside of our house. So we look at our garage as it's semi-insulated, at least on three walls. The door isn't that well insulated, but we can at least use that space. We can set up a tent inside so we have privacy and a little bit, and tents can keep in an extra warmth. There's different ways of adding layers of blankets and tarps to actually keep that insulated a little bit warmer. But that's really that thought of choosing a safe room or your operations room. Where are you going to sleep? Where are you going to eat? Where are you going to cook? In your, you know, try to pick a room that has, you know, for us, we have big slider doors in our living room and then on our den downstairs. And if those are broken, there's going to be a lot, that's a lot of space for cold air or rain or water to get in. If we can cover it, we will, just to prevent that additional damage. But you know, that's not necessarily going to be as insulated as our garage that we can, if we close the door, we have four sides of actual coverage and wind protection and just really creating that safe room condition and some privacy and a way of securing our things. So that's just a really big consideration if you're sheltering at home after a disaster. We always recommend having some boards and tools to cover broken spaces. So whether it's windows or doors, you know, how are you going to secure that space? Plastic sheeting and duct tape to repair windows. I'll tell you, one of the things I learned from a colleague that went through the Alaska earthquakes in 2018, they actually were in the middle of painting their house. So they had all of this plastic painter sheeting that they got at Home Depot, which is not very expensive. And what they did is they went outside and they taped over the windows with duct tape. And then on the inside, right, you get the window frame. So you have a, you know, a 4 to 6 inch space. They actually put like extra clothes and blankets and sweatshirts in that space and then duct tape on the inside and created their safe room using insulation of clothes and just the plastic sheeting. So although their windows were broken, which was, you know, unfortunate, they chose a safe room and they had a plan for it. And they were able to insulate their room. Now that was in Alaska in, I think it was the end of November, beginning of December. So not a great time to not have windows in your house. So they were able to basically cover all of their windows and then insulate a few rooms for them to actually have their living space while they waited for boards and other repair materials to come into the region as part of the disaster repair. Canopies, pop-up canopies, not necessarily the greatest for traveling, you know, a tailgating canopy type of thing. You know, they're great when you have a, hey, I'm just going to pop this up and doesn't take up a lot of space, but those can be a really great option, again, either to set up a tent underneath so you have that extra protection, or use it as really just how do you try to protect your home, or how do you just have a contained space that is identified as your space. Now, there's also a whole concept out there of the shed plan for emergency preparedness. There's a lot of people that have sheds that turn them into either a she shed or a he shed, whatever you want to call it, a bunkhouse. There's a lot of great options. And personally, in our shed, that's actually part of my entire emergency plan, is that if we have to evacuate our house, you know, and I'm worried about going in there because in a Cascadia type earthquake, there may be 3 to 5 days of aftershocks. My shed is set far enough away from my house. I'm not worried about my house falling on it. So if I have a shed that is already waterproof and it's plywood, so it's not super insulated, but it stops the wind, it stops some of the other elements. And if there's a heater in there, it can warm up pretty well. So we actually have a tent. We have some of our cooking supplies, some of our extra supplies in there, because that's my kind of 2 hours to 72 hour plan, or a little bit longer as I'm starting to repair my home and get back into a better safe room, is to get out of my house, get to the shed, use that as initial containment of my dog and initial just kind of staging area as we try to figure out what's going on and the initial recovery. So if you have a property with a shed, that's a great option. If you don't, if you're in an apartment, again, having tents and just some of these basic supplies can make a huge difference. I know people that have detached garages that they use like a shed plan, or they have, they specifically buy a tarp that will cover the entire front side of that. Because if your door is damaged and either you can't open, won't open, or is broken, and or you have to cut through it to get into it, that is an option sometimes, you do want to be able to create, again, that barrier that would protect some warmth. So just having that as consideration can be really, it's just another option is sheds. Now, shelter support items. This goes into what, again, goes back really into that whole 2 weeks ready concept. What are we looking for? What do we need to be okay for 2 weeks as we start to repair our home and recover from a large disaster? Now, depending on the time of year, can really vary that. But really, one of those fundamental things is if you have you have shelter. Okay, great, we have shelter. Now, what's the next most hazardous thing? Being cold. So what is your sleeping bag or bedding option? Sleeping bags are great. If you don't want to go buy a sleeping bag, if you're not an avid camper and you're not going to use a sleeping bag ever, it's cool to have for emergencies, but having extra blankets stored somewhere that's readily available can be a huge, huge benefit to you. That also goes into if you're doing something for emergency and you may never use it, go to Goodwill, right? I have a number of blankets and an old sleeping bag that I got at Goodwill because it was like $20. It was a zero down sleeping bag. Sure. You know what? It's not something I want to use on my regular hiking camping trip because it was somebody's sleeping bag sometime, but an emergency kit that I will use in an emergency when I'm, you know, my life is pretty much probably just falling apart. Yeah. Okay. I'll take a funky smelling sleeping bag any day, as long as I stay warm. So think about what that bedding supply is. Even an air mattress might be a good option, or a ground pad. And that's one of those bullets here. And how are you going to power that? I personally, again, I like backpacking. So I've done, you know, 72 hour, 48 hour backpacking plans, or, you know, a 5 day backpacking trip, where it's, you have what you carry. So, very light sleeping bag, tent, and ground pad. So I don't like sleeping on the ground anymore, and it provides insulation. Again, you can get those all over the place. Sierra Trading Post often has discounted ones on clearance. I got my wife a ground pad for, I think, $8, which is an insulated ground pad. It provides about a 3-inch air mattress, essentially, that's used for camping and stuff. But I think it was $8 to $12 or something like that at Sierra Trading Post here in Salem. Rope and duct tape. That can be incredibly important for if you're going with the tarp scenario, or you need to tape things over. I have 10 rolls of duct tape at my house, just half of them in a bin. And then I have a whole bunch of different ropes. So what I look for is a polypropylene rope, a plastic rope. So that way, if it's running in, you know, if it's that line that is the center line of a canopy or a tarp, that it's not going to get waterlogged and run water all the way in. So polypropylene, it's just a plastic style rope you can get all over the place, almost any hardware store. And I have a few spools of that. So kind of planning on how I'm going to use and what I'm going to use, because I don't really want water in my, it's Oregon. It rains all the time. Let's be honest. Tools for home repair or stabilization. If you have boards to cover up doors and windows, have some screws and a way of actually putting that in, whether it's a battery powered drill or a hand, you know, really just a hand screwdriver. Heat options. Now, there are plenty of ways to have a small fireplace, to have a heater. If you have a generator, again, that's one of those things that really improves your shelter support opportunities. I actually just had a long conversation with a colleague about generators and their use during emergencies. You know, for me, my generator is I have a generator, and the plan for that was to be able to power a fridge and a freezer, some lights, and then a heater. So I have a 3,400 watt generator, and that will allow me to basically power my fridge and freezer through the time it's going to take me to eat all of the things in my fridge that will expire. And then provide me heat if I need it. So I can turn on a little space heater and have that contained again in my little safe room or recovery room. Think about bathroom needs. This is something that we always talk about, the twin bucket system, having a plan for that. Having an extra tarp to kind of section off an area. It may be you may be actually using your bathroom in your home for a twin bucket system or a bathroom situation. If not, we have a little pop-up. It's like a beach tent. So it's literally a beach changing tent. It's maybe 48 inches around. It's not that big. But it's designed to pop up and put a toilet in it. And it's something that we see in the military all the time. It's basically a small little fold up thing. It turns into a circle and it unfolds. Get them on Amazon for about $25 or so. And then think about a communications plan. If you are evacuating or staying at home, or you have people planning to come over to shelter together, have you communicated that with them? Have you had that conversation? If you're leaving your home, can you tell somebody? Can you leave a note? Can you reach out and tell people? And then, as always, pet considerations. Pets will freak out. You're going to want to try to get them in a safe space. So it might be a matter of, do I have something sturdy that I can anchor my pet to on a leash while I clean up and pick up broken glass, deal with all that stuff that will injure my pet and cause more problems in the long run? One thing I didn't put apparently that bullet at the bottom was supposed to be this, and apparently didn't carry over when I saved it. But how do you secure your items? Personally, the plastic totes that I have that are also my wash basins, they have the holes in them so I could actually lock them if I wanted to. And that would be, you know, in an extreme situation where I am living in a, you know, multi-person camp trying to share, manage supplies, manage what I have. Again, if I am going to a situation like that, where I am going to a mass care camp or an evacuation camp, something like that, I'm going to bring a whole bunch of supplies. I'm going to bring documents. I'm going to bring as much food and water as I can bring, anything I need for my pets, anything I need. I'll bring toilet paper and hand sanitizer, things that will commonly run out. And then any comfort items that I want, whether it's books, a ground pad for sleeping, my own sleeping bag. Because I'll tell you, most, you know, if we're talking about a big event, there's not going to be enough to go around. So bringing your own supplies and hoping that you're going to get more is going to be really important. So how do you think about how you would transport some of those things? Again, I always go back to, do you have a wagon? Can you use a plastic trash bin that has wheels on it? You know, throw all your stuff in that and wheel it with you. And then you have a way of containing that. Drill a hole in it so you could put a lock on it if you needed to. But just think about how you would actually have support if you had to go to evacuate to a shelter. So again, are you going to an established shelter? What do you need to bring with you? This goes back to that whole thing, is what do you have with you? What are you going to need with you? And actually take time to think about this. If I had to leave my home, what would I want? And I was going somewhere where I was hopefully going to get supplies. Well, first off, food, water, medication, things for my pets, any comfort items I want. I'm probably going to bring a tent if I have it. I'm going to bring a ground pad, a fold-up chair, maybe an extra little camp stove, something that's going to let me boil water, clean water, if that's a problem. Are you going to a friend or relatives? So do you have somewhere out of the impacted zone to go? Is that around that? Are you going to an established shelter? Part of the plan is to set up an onward evacuation point from Salem Airport. So if you could had somewhere to go, you know, my family lives in the East Coast. So if I could evacuate my wife and my dog and put them on a plane and send them to the East Coast where they could live with my family while we deal with a disaster response, I will absolutely do that. So how do I get them there? How do I get that process and how do I make it happen so I don't have to worry about them? Are you going to a friend or relatives? Do you have a conjoined plan with friends and other relatives that may be in the area that you can work with? Are you going to that mass shelter or evacuation camp? What are you going to want for privacy? What are you going to want that you're worried will be in shortage? And I'll tell you, food, water, medications, toilet paper, those will all become very short, very quickly. And then what should you shut off if you're leaving your home? So one of those big considerations, and this goes especially to power outages, what should you shut off if you're leaving your home? If there's no power and you're going to leave your home for a long time, and it is, we're talking, you know, very cold conditions in the freezing zone, so below 30 degrees, you're probably going to want to shut off your water intake to your house so that way your pipes don't freeze and drain your pipes as much as possible. So that's shutting that valve off at the street and then running your system to try to get that water out of your system so it doesn't freeze and crack and create additional problems. You may want to shut off power, your actual circuit breaker to your house, because if everything's still on and the power comes back on, it could create an electrical surge or at least unplug any sensitive items. So whether it's TVs, medical equipment or computers, unplug those or make sure they're plugged into a circuit breaker. It can be really, really useful to save your equipment. In some cases, if it's a shorter power outage or you're still at home, we encourage you to leave one light on inside and one light on outside, because if there's a somebody working on the power in the street and they do something and the power, you know, a couple lights turn on the outside of homes, they know they're working on the right thing. So really think about what to shut off or what you should take out of your home. If you have a bunch of food that's going to spoil while you're gone, it might behoove you to just throw it away before you leave. Now, one other thing is a hazmat shelter in place. Now, this is if you ever get a notification that says hazmat event in your area, shelter in place. And this is basically the thought that there is a hazardous materials chemical plume that is floating by your home. And it is, you are highly encouraged to get indoors, not be in a car, to try to find indoor shelter as soon as possible. Choose a room with as limited windows as doors as possible. For us, it's a bathroom at our home. And then block the doors or windows with towels. Try to really pack it so that way there's no air coming through. Before you go in there or once you're in there, shut off the HVAC, the heating vent. HVAC is heating, ventilation, air condition. So for us, we turn off our HVAC system, run down into this room, grab the towels, lock it in there, and then we plan for 3 to 5 hours. So we actually, in this room, we already have a little bucket that has dog food, snacks, water bottles, phone charger, just some extra phone chargers, and books for us to kind of be comfortable for 3 to 5 hours in this room. Now, this is the idea that a chemical plume is blowing by your house. And if it gets into your house, you want time for it to cycle through or to not impact you directly. So you're trying to create a room that doesn't have a lot of airflow that would bring a chemical in with you. Plan for pets. So we have one toy that we know our dog will go nuts for no matter where he is. If we squeak this toy, he is coming for it. So we actually have one of those in this room with the intent that if we get this notification, we're running in there, we can squeak the toy and he's going to come from wherever he is and join us in that room. So planning for your pets, how will you contain them? Do you have food, water? What else do you need? Any medications? So just one of those extra thoughts about emergency shelter, and that's that hazmat shelter in place. And again, the best way you will be notified for that is through the Marion Polk Alerts, the Everbridge system. You can find the sign up for that through cityofsalem.net/alerts. Or just cityofsalem and then .net. And then there's an emergency alert, sign up for emergency alerts notification. And the intent there is that if there is a hazmat event, we will draw the circle of where we are concerned. We'll do a shelter in place for the people in the immediate impacted area. And we'll do an evacuation for those that are safe, will have enough time to safely go outside and evacuate from the area. There was a big study done a couple of years ago that about 90 or 80 something percent of evacuations should have been shelter in places initially, and everything would have been fine. So a little bit of education and training, we can be a lot safer. So at this time, if there are any questions, please pop them in the chat. Thank you for talking, for listening to me talk about shelters. All types of great options out there. There's a lot of great materials and places in the city of Salem that sell these great things, or online on Amazon. And really, you just have to do a little bit of assessment on what works for you and what will work for your property and then your emergency kits. So again, for me, I have sleeping bags and tents and blankets and space blankets in my car kits, with the intent that I will be getting back to a location that is, with the intent of getting back to a safer space for me where I have more supplies.